Good evening, and welcome to the third Nike-sponsored Sports and Social Change Speaker Series. I have the distinct honor of introducing the Dean of the Annenberg School for Communication and Journalism, who then will turn around and introduce me. The Dean of the Annenberg School for Communication, Ernest Wilson.
Thank you, Dan, and I want to thank you for the good work that you're doing to make this such a great success. I'm glad that a few of you wandered in this evening, and I think we, how many, this room holds how many, Dan? A million? Holds about a million people, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, a million and a half.
I think we have a million and a half here this evening. But I really do want to welcome you to this great event. We've got a wonderful panel that you'll have the opportunity to hear from. I just want to say a few words of welcome. This is the third Sports and Social Change Speaker Series program that we've had here at the Annenberg School for Communication and Journalism. And it's supported by a very generous grant from the Nike Corporation. And I want to thank them for their generous support. And I want to thank personally each of our panelists who've taken time out of their very busy schedules to come and join us this evening. We're very proud of this speaker series. It's really one of the most popular that we do at the Annenberg School, and it draws students from all across the campus who are interested in the ways that media and society come together to influence one another in a mutual sort of way. Let me just rattle off a couple of statistics as professors are wont to do. The Sports, Media, and Society program teaches more than 400 students a semester. That's 400 students a semester here at the here in the Annenberg School in a variety of academic programs. We've also just launched in the past year a minor in sports studies, sports media studies. So for those of you who are students who haven't signed up yet, you can sign up in your in the university. And it's now currently the fastest growing program in the school. So we have a minor program there as well. In addition, we are doing, we're hiring, we've hired top professionals in the sports industry, working on issues of ethics in sports media, et cetera. We've hired three, if not four, new professors in this area. So we're devoting a great deal of attention to this because, as someone told me recently, the sports industry in the United States is larger than the automobile industry in the United States. It's significantly economic, it's significant economically, culturally, politically, et cetera. And so I think that tonight's program may be the most exciting yet of the three that we have we've had, with the leaders of several teams and sports media groups gathered to discuss the future of sports. The Institute for Sports, Media, and Society has also gone international. It's impossible to be interested in any topic and just have it be domestic. And so my colleagues have just returned from an international sports program, which was held, they had the misfortune of having to travel to Paris. It was such a difficult program, I know, have to do that. But they did go to the Sorbonne in Paris for the first program in an international initiative that we're launching here at the Annenberg School. And it will continue in a foreign location and then back in L.A. and will alternate back and forth. We're very, very excited about that as well. The Annenberg Institute of Sports, Media, and Society is also collaborating with our Intersections program, which was a program in the journalism school, which is to teach sports journalism to students in high school, to get them interested in journalism through their interest in sports, and to improve their interest in sports by being more accessible and open to journalism. We're also working, we've created a new relationship with what we call the Annenberg Innovation Laboratory, which has 15 corporate sponsors. It's been described by MarketWatch as the new Silicon Valley right here on campus. And what we're working on there is a cutting-edge research on the impact of tweeting on fan responses to major sports events. That's another very exciting piece of research that we're doing. So as you can see, this program continues to grow. It's got five or six components. It is growing. It's probably the fastest growing program we have at the Annenberg School. And we really look forward to announcing even more programs for more students in the coming weeks and months. As many of you know, the growth of this program and others at Annenberg and around the University of Southern California really depend on the generosity of our many friends and supporters. With these quickly evolving programs, the Annenberg Institute of Sports, Media, and Society provides many opportunities for interested supporters to help fund programs that have a special interest to our Annenberg students. So I encourage all of you who are from the industry, who would like to talk to our students, get involved with our research, to be sure to talk to Dan afterwards. One of my favorite expressions since becoming dean 4 years ago is that we either innovate or we die. That's true for companies, it's true for political parties, and it's even true for universities. And what I'm very proud to say is under the leadership of President Max Nikias, that has become a resounding theme in everything we do at the University of Southern California, including here at the Annenberg School. And so we believe we're at the forefront of innovation. We're collaborating with people on campus, with people off campus, with people in Europe, in China. And this is, we are convinced that this is the field of the future. It brings together so many important issues. It's very exciting. It's economically important. It's culturally important. And so, again, I want to welcome each and every one of you to this program. This will not be the last one that we do. We'll be doing at least two a year. We have a program coming up, Ben, if I'm not mistaken, on the Olympics that will be taking place in Brazil. Please keep coming back. And we look forward to seeing you in the future. Thanks so much, and thanks so much for our panel for coming this evening. Dan?
Well, I'd like to think I was going to Brazil. Good evening. Before we talk to our panel, I wanted to thank the dean for his support on this program and involvement, and also for introducing us all this evening, or introducing this project this evening. I also want to point out a couple of people. This is kind of like Ed Sullivan. I need to point out a couple of people in the crowd before we get going. And I do this because those of you who were here a year ago may remember that I was basically trying to get USC to admit that I worked here. And in fact, at this point, we have a variety of people working in the field of sports and sports media studies at Annenberg. We have developed a number of new hires, and I want to introduce a couple of people just to point them out who are here and mention a couple of people who are not here, sadly. Those were the people who were smart enough to stay in Paris when they got there, and they'll be back in a few days. But first of all, I wanted to mention we have with us this evening Alan Abrahamson, who is a twice New York Times bestselling author and also one of the top experts on the Olympics. Alan led a group of academics and professionals to Paris, France just a week ago as part of our program for an international discussion of sports and sports media studies. And Alan, could you stand up for just a second so everybody can see you and recognize you? Well, I didn't say you had to applaud him. But anyway, Alan is heading up our master's degree in specialized journalism and sports journalism, and has, as you can tell, taken the bull by the horns right from the start and is aggressively involved in the programming that we have here. Also, right next to Alan is Arit Yellen, who is a new hire in our sports public relations program. And Arit has a long history. She developed her own company in sports public relations and is now a teacher and mentor in our program for those in the master's degree of sports public relations. Is Taj Frazier here? I didn't see him. Okay. Taj Frazier also has been developing some courses in sports and visual culture and is teaching in our program. And also Bill Morgan, who I do believe, Bill is certainly not here, correct? Yeah, I thought so. Okay, I just wanted to make sure. Yeah, Bill Morgan was the one who was really smart in all of this. He stayed in Paris with his wife, Susan Metros. But Bill is one of the top sports scholars in the country, specializes in sports and philosophy and sports and critical studies, and has a laundry list of publications it's an embarrassment of riches. And Bill is working with us. He was part of the Paris program, is also working in developing courses for Annenberg. So we have a growing academic and research program, and it is persistently growing and growing very quickly. Also, I want to mention we have here on the side over here Evan Brody, who was also part of the Paris contingent. Just to show you that this isn't just professors, we also have a PhD candidate who's doing important research in critical studies in sports and gave some really important contributions to the discussion in Paris. So we have a broad spectrum of people working on this, and we're very, very proud of all of these people. They're making this program run. And just one last thing, because I really have to mention this, speaking of making this program run, John Hackett at the very, very back is the man who keeps me alive. And I would actually be a wandering, blithering idiot most of the time, more of the time than I am, actually, most of the time I am. But I would be even more so if John weren't taking care of me. He's the program coordinator for the Annenberg Institute of Sports, Media, and Society. You should get to know John because he knows where all the bodies are buried in this program, and he can get you online to our new website that just went up yesterday, and check with John. He can give you the web address, but our full website was just put online yesterday, so you can check that out at aisms.usc.annenberg.org, but you can figure that out later. John will tell you. This evening, we're going to be discussing the future of sports and sports media with some of the top people across a broad variety of sports. And I will venture to say right now that you will not be able to get together a panel of such impressive experts and media professionals and sports professionals in this lifetime, very likely. And I want to introduce each one of them before we begin our discussion. First of all, in the center, you'll see Robert Sarver, who is the owner of the Phoenix Suns. Also how many things of your accomplishments do you want me to talk about?
That's enough.
That's enough, okay. So I've got about 12 pages of stuff here. One of the most forward-thinking financial minds and certainly a leader in a variety of charitable causes. Robert Sarver is also the owner of the Phoenix Suns, and he has agreed to talk to us this evening about the future of sports and sports media. And you can applaud. To Robert's left is Paula Madison, who's the owner of the Los Angeles Sparks of the WNBA after a long career with NBC Sports. Paula, for a variety of reasons, helped head up a group that purchased the Los Angeles Sparks, really to try to push forward on a lot of fronts some really important developments in the WNBA and in women's basketball. So if you could greet Paula Madison, please. Molly Jolly, who's on the other side of Robert, we're working our way kind of spirally out, is the Senior Vice President of Finance and Administration for the Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim, as opposed to the Los Angeles Dodgers of Los Angeles, the Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim. And Molly has been working, it's been 11 years, I think, now with the Angels, correct? And has worked with the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim hockey team, and runs all of the financial and administrative concerns for the Angels. So can give us a lot of details about how the finances of Major League Baseball corporations work. So if you could say hello to Molly Jolly. In the early 1990s, two people really were at the core of developing Fox Sports, and one of them doesn't like to boast about it, so he doesn't talk about it nearly as much, but is key to the development of Fox Sports into what it is. Ed Goren spent many years working with CBS Sports and moved on to Fox Sports at the start of the development of that entity, and has helped make Fox Sports really one of the most dynamic and powerful sports media groups in the world. And so Ed has graciously consented to also talk to us about sports and sports media. If you could give Ed, way over on the other side, a welcoming hand. And finally, Mike James, who is sitting right over here next to me, who somehow looks like a, doesn't he look like a newsman from like a TV show in the 60s? He's very, he's got that kind of L.A. look to him. He's the senior sports...
I'm not sure how to respond to
that. No, it's a compliment. You know, it's totally a compliment. Trust me, I think. Mike is the sports editor of the Los Angeles Times, a newspaper, of course, that is one of the most renowned newspapers, and certainly a sports department, one of the most well-known sports departments in the country, and has guided the Los Angeles Times over a number of years, and been involved in a number of the major stories that are going on, including stories that are going on today. So Mr. James is probably going to have to leave and rush back out to the Times sometime immediately after our program to make sure all of the important stuff gets out. But welcome him and thank him for coming to. This is a time of dynamic change for sports and sports media in the United States. The tectonic shifts in media have necessitated swift change in sports reporting, sports production, and the development and promotion of sports franchises. The NBA is currently locked in a struggle between owners and players, a struggle largely centered on the revenue generated by media, and this is not unique. The NFL was caught up in the same sort of discussion less than a year ago. So in all aspects of the game, media continues to play a central role in the viability and future of sports franchises. Media, however, is swiftly changing. Sports organizations must be ready to innovate to meet the new media needs. As those of you who have been here for any period of time know, you can no longer be a sports organization in the classic sense of the word and want to be on major network television and have that be the sole source of revenue for you in media. There are an infinite number of media platforms, and sports organizations have to evolve in order to meet those needs and in order to accomplish their goals. This evening we will discuss the role of media in sports production and the future of sports franchises and leagues as they seek to provide content for, as they seek sometimes to control, and certainly as they always seek to be seen on media. I want to begin the discussion a little bit with media and technology and some of the changes that have occurred. Mr. Sarver has been owner of the Phoenix Sun since 2004. Now, those of you who were hanging out in 2004, and I'm guessing that's everyone in the room, would probably recall that at that point, Twitter was essentially meaningless. Facebook was just beginning to develop its audience. And we still really were at the tail end of the major network era in television and the real rise of a variety of television platforms. Over the last, 2004 would make that 7 years, over the last 7 years, Robert, could you talk to us about changes as an owner of a major sports organization, changes in the way in which you've had to deal with media and to try to place your team on media?
Sure. Well, first of all, last night my kids said, what do you doing tomorrow night? I said, I'm going to be in L.A. I got to talk about social media. I said, Dad, you don't have a Facebook page. You don't use Twitter. And you still have a flip phone. What do they want you for? That's a good question. But forget about the last 7 years. I'd say just the last 12 or 18 months, the changes have just been astounding. Just yesterday, we were the first NBA team to have a Google Plus page. We were one of 20 global brands that were invited by Google to participate first. We've got 625,000 followers on Facebook. A year ago, we had 125,000. We're selling tickets through Twitter, through Facebook. We hired for the first time a social media sideline reporter who instead of talking about what's going on at the game is going to be dealing with what people are saying about what's going on in the game, following people on Twitter and things that are trending and things. The business has changed significantly. Our corporate marketing partners want to tap into our social media, what we do from a social media standpoint to access customers. The whole idea of having your customers help sell your product versus you selling your product has changed. And so social media has really changed the whole way we operate, especially during games even. Even during games, you mentioned You know, it's not just enough to be on a television watching the game, but everyone's using social media. It's almost like a kind of an online sports bar during a game. So our whole approach to how we do business and how we market the Phoenix Suns has taken a dramatic change over the last 18 months through social media.
Paula, you are in many respects a larger market and a much more diverse and fast-changing market with many options in terms of entertainment and sports to view. Talking from the perspective of somebody working within the WNBA, how do you shape the message of your team to be consistent and to sell across these various media?
Well, you know, when the WNBA first started 15 years ago, there was a lot of interest in it because, excuse me, there hadn't been really as high profile a women's sports organization, or women's sports organizations or franchises or leagues until really the WNBA. And, you know, then we had the advent of Lisa Leslie, who was the first woman to dunk, which was really big. And then we had Candace Parker, who was the second woman to dunk, both of whom, by the way, LA Sparks, were Lisa retired. But what we found was that as time went by, there was a big surge, I think, at the outset. And the messaging really was about, in the very beginning, it was almost like we're not guy basketball. Mm-hmm. We are women's basketball, and we're interesting too, mm-hmm. right? And in talking to some of the players, we were having this conversation this summer. Some of the players were really not happy about that kind of positioning, that kind of marketing and branding. And then I think it evolved to we got next. And they still weren't happy about that because, again, more often than not, the messaging was that we're basketball. We're not guys basketball, but you can come and watch us too. Now, when I first started watching the WNBA, and I who grew up in Harlem and watched basketball, men's basketball, my whole life, I sort of watched it and thought, this really is girl ball. Mm-hmm. And then about 5 years ago, it stopped being girl ball. Mm-hmm. And now it's really dude ball. Mm-hmm. And they play hard and they play rough. And it's the kind of basketball play that I enjoy. So the messaging now is interesting because the women are taller, they're stronger, they're more athletic. And the messaging that the WNBA wants to get out about the teams is that it's good family fun, and you will see a great game of basketball. Overwhelmingly, at least for the Sparks and in most of the WNBA teams, the fan base in the arenas is largely comprised of families. Mm-hmm. So we have grandparents, we have children, we have mothers, fathers, we have father-daughter night. Father-daughter night this year for the Sparks was a sellout. And interestingly, too, the diversity overwhelmingly, again, for the fans are largely women, but also, at least in L.A., a huge percentage of our fans are Latino. And Latinos come as families, they come as couples, groups hanging out, and again, because it's good, clean fun, the real battle for the WNBA, frankly, is to generate enough revenue so that our players can be like his players, so that they are paid year-round, mm-hmm. and they don't have to go overseas to play ball. Our players almost must play overseas in order to earn the kinds of incomes which eclipse what we pay in the WNBA. They make high six figures, seven figures playing overseas. They don't make that kind of money here, but the only way that they can get a spot on an overseas team is to be a WNBA player. That results in the women remaining injured almost the entire year. So whereas the men can recover, the women never recover.
Mm-hmm. I want to do a quick follow-up on that because there's an interesting point you made right at the start that the success of stars in the WNBA, especially initially, was tied to athletic accomplishment. Now, one of the long-standing criticism of sports and sports media and sports in general is that when it treats the female athlete, it very often celebrates the female athlete for everything except athletic accomplishment. What are the ways in which the Sparks and the WNBA are trying to create a message of athletic accomplishment to sell that as the league's brand and image?
Well, you know, this one gets a little touchy, mm-hmm. And that's because we do want to promote the athleticism, and it's important that we do that, particularly as we're approaching the 40th anniversary of Title IX. Mm-hmm. I don't think women have to make any apologies for being athletic. Mm-hmm. However, we frankly sometimes have some difficulty generating the kind of advertising revenue, because that athleticism sometimes translates to a perception that means that the women aren't interested in men. That the perception that most of the women in the WNBA are lesbians. And there are, I think, a good number and a considerable number. And I don't know why that impacts on marketing. But that's kind of the hushed, not really talked about in large rooms discussion that goes on. And there are, frankly, a lot of advertisers who are willing to step up and support. But there are a lot more who talk about, well, this may not really be how we want to brand our product. We may not want to identify. And I think it's important, frankly, that the public and fans understand that's another hurdle that the WNBA has to overcome. Not that there are lesbians on our teams, nothing to overcome there, but that there's something not marketable about having lesbians on the team. So the athleticism is one that I think is important, should be celebrated. And by the way, Candace Parker modeled a swimsuit in the Sports Illustrated swimsuit issue. You know, she's married to an NBA player and has a child. And I, frankly, my husband and I took some of our team to see Prince this summer. Yes, in LA. And they were all dressed up. And I was like, wow. These chicks look good. So what I'm most interested in doing is presenting a well-rounded picture of who the WNBA players are. Not that they are women who are running up and down the court in jerseys and shorts solely. That is a part of what they do. But the other part of what they do is many of them are mothers, their partners, their spouses, and they're very active in our communities working on a variety of issues that deal with quality of life. And I think that it's important for the public to know that, but we don't have as much time to market our players because they're really only with us for the season.
Yeah, fascinating. Following up on, speaking of sports that have some challenges in terms of public perception, Major League Baseball was quite fortunate to have a very compelling World Series this year. The previous year, the World Series was not the most well-rated sports production on any media. And Major League Baseball has been dealing with, for many years, the difficulties of translating a slow-paced game on very fast-paced media and to audiences that have a number of other choices, including NBA basketball and NFL football, which tend to have a much faster pace. It's looking at this from the perspective of somebody who is runs the finances of a Major League Baseball organization. How do you monetize this sport, both to fans in the stands, but especially from media, in order to create the financial base that you need to sustain the Angels or any Major League Baseball organization, and to develop a successful team? Molly, sorry. should have actually said your name somewhere along the line. Would have been helpful.
At the local level, I mean, our focus is our local market, and we are a turnstile business, so our emphasis in our in-game production is to advertise the Angels. We see it as an infomercial, the way we show the stadium, the presentation of what the experience is like at a game. But in addition to that, we're also providing a product, so if you choose to stay at home, that you're learning and we're educating you about our team, about our players. What I found interesting during the World Series and initiatives that MLB has pursued at a league level is to try to make the game interactive. Our average age is 45 years old. This year they rolled out kind of on the fly, the MLB fan cave, where really appealed. They had two guys in a cave, watched all 2,400 games this year, and it really took off with the 28-year-olds. It embraced a younger demographic. I think that's ways that MLB can appeal. The in-game tweets that happened during the World Series were highly effective, I think, in capturing a younger demo. MLB's looking at ways to be more interactive with the viewers to basically drive more participation in the sport.
You know, I'm going to just jump in and talk about baseball a little bit. First off, the slow pace of the game. We were in St. Louis for many hours for Game 6 of the World Series. Not one viewer complained about the slow pace of the game. You can have a bad football game, and it will feel like it takes forever. So it's not just the pace of the game. The other thing about baseball, and I think it gets a bad rap. Mm-hmm. How many millions of fans came through your turnstile this year?
We had over 3 million paid tickets and 2.8 million turnstiles.
All right, so 3 million paid tickets. Baseball attendance, even in a down economy, has held up very, very well. And as far as the economics of the sport beyond ticket sales, thanks to folks like Fox, the local revenue for television rights would be the envy, I think, of every league short of that wonderful deal that the Lakers made with Time Warner. But the Dodgers will actually get their opportunity at some point to top that deal. Mm-hmm. So the revenue side of baseball and the following is very healthy. That has nothing to do with the network. The health of network sports, but certainly on a local level. In fact, one of the things, one of the big issues in the World Series was important, I think, for baseball and for Fox. As a local entity, the following for baseball is significant. Once you get on that national stage, and we have not had a repeat winner in the World Series for how many years? The Texas Rangers, the first team to go back-to-back years in a World Series in a long time. So you rely on the national following of teams. So every year the baseball season starts, and each night before I go to sleep, I say, "Dear Lord, can we get the Yankees or Red Sox in the World Series?" And I know this is ridiculous, but what about the Cubs? Just once in my life. And those are the only three teams that really have a national following.
We're working on it.
You go down to Manhattan Beach, you'll see as many Red Sox, Yankees hats, Cubs hats. So that's the challenge, I think, for the sport, to sell their stars nationally, and as important as the stars, the teams themselves.
But still, Ed, you talk about the overall popularity of the sport, and you mentioned the ratings from last year being very low, but if we get stuck on ratings, how many million people are we talking about?
Well, first off, the writers, not the writers.
Not
yeah, yeah, the writers, everybody but the LA Times. The writers still think that it's 1975 and you have five channels to pick from. And they're going to compare the ratings from 1975 to what they are today. That low-rated World Series, and Dan, you have every reason to believe that it was low-rated. It was actually the lowest rated. And I thought we were going to do worse this year, and we got real lucky and had a great World Series. But compared to a Pittsburgh-Baltimore World Series 30 years ago, when there were only five channels, that World Series was the eighth-rated, highest-rated show in all of television with five channels. Now, in this universe of 500 channels and all the other opportunities for social media and, you know, whatever you want to do, that low-rated World Series a year ago was the eighth-rated show in all of television. So you can't necessarily, it's not apples to apples, but the Yankees or Red Sox or Cubs would help.
Yeah, would help, yeah. But that cuts right to the core of the conversation on one level, but I have a follow-up question from what Molly said for you. But you have this multiple platform set, and you have to keep monetizing your product on this. How do you effectively monetize a product that in all honesty, many people, especially young people, see as boring, but more particularly, as Molly indicated, primarily, you know, how old is the general audience for?
45.
That's not a preferred audience in television production. You prefer, you know, an 18 to 30-ish audience. How do you generate a younger audience?
The World Series did fine in the key demos.
Yeah.
Game 7 of the World Series was on a Friday night. As you all know, that's the lowest viewership of any night of the year. I think that our rating for Fox that night was the highest rating we've had in ever on a Friday night. So the ratings this year, and you whether it's the NBA or baseball or the WNBA, if there's a series sweep, it's not a memorable series. And you have nothing to build on. You can't build ratings. But you get to a 6 or 7, all of a sudden, it feeds off itself. And the viewership in the demo was number one each night. I think 6 out of the 7 nights. One night, we lost to Dancing with somebody. B-list celebrities.
Along with that, however, the statement then would seem to indicate that you rely on how compelling the games are in order to gain your audience. But in fact, Fox is really, to give Fox its due, it has made its name by making a lot of things compelling that weren't necessarily compelling in and of themselves in sports, adding excitement to it, adding interest to it. What does Fox do? And let's take baseball because that's what we're talking about. What does Fox do in particular with baseball in order to make baseball always compelling or as compelling as it can be?
Well, it's not always compelling, but
as compelling as it can be.
But we were talking about it earlier that when we started in 96 with our first baseball deal, and I had 4 years of baseball at CBS in the 80s, back in the 80s, we couldn't get baseball to help the broadcast in any fashion. We're the national pastime, and therefore we don't have to do anything, which is a terrible position for any sport to take. When we started in 96, we worked with the Players Association, we worked with ownership, we worked with the commissioner and his broadcast department, and a lot of the things that we were allowed to do now translate into local broadcasts, interviews with managers between in-game. Now the NBA has started doing that, the NHL has started doing that. Texas Rangers pitcher Holland, in Game 3 of the World Series, was on with us during the game. And it was a wonderful, personable interview. And he does a great Harry Carey to boot that he auditioned.
Well, everybody does Harry.
During, I know, it's so easy. Well, you have to have a lot to drink before you do it. But we've added cameras. We've added mics to the bases. We've had umpires mic. We've had umpires wearing cameras, we've had catchers wearing cameras, and we've put literally cameras on the field, embedded in the field. So we've tried to make the broadcast more entertaining, visually more attractive, and then we get into those tweets and that stuff that neither of us understand, but have become more and more important.
Yeah, I was rather horrified when I saw the flip phone. That was the.
It doesn't pocket that.
Yeah, well, that's.
There you go.
Man has a point. Yeah, that is true. We haven't forgotten you, Mike. In fact, this comes and circles back to a discussion of really the first voice that most people hear about sports. Certainly, it used to be the newspaper. But the news media has always been the front line of telling the story of sports. In a market where the news media is changing so rapidly, how is the sports department of the LA Times in particular, or sports departments in general, how are you having to grapple with the changes in media and the various platforms on which the story can be told?
Well, the changes in our business have been seismic, like they have been in for everyone here. We're in a different position because we're not in Ed's job. It benefits him to promote the sport that he's covering. He's a partner with that. We're not partners. We are at times adversaries. But what is, by nature, that's the way.
Yeah, but
not really. Not always.
Not really, because, sometimes when you read the article, yeah. But at the end of the day, you really are partners because, that's what people pick up by the newspapers
ultimately, what we're doing
is at the end of the day, you are.
We're covering what you are doing, and right. By that simple coverage, we are, regardless of what we're saying, we're promoting it because right. It's out there.
Right. But don't you also set the tone in a way? Set a mindset in a community.
I
read those letters to the editor. I read TJ.
We certainly establish priorities in that way. But in terms of the multiple platforms, one of the complications that we deal with is that the business as a whole has contracted so much over the last six or eight years that we're smaller and we've got to be a lot leaner. And for what we do, at the LA Times, we sort of have as our mission covering Southern California and being the ultimate news voice in Southern California and the place you have to go if you want the real story of whatever big stories are. The complication there is in our digital presentation, it is that as its basis, but in addition, for us to be competitive, we have to have a national slant there. So there's a great deal of energy every day in our department to keep our website and our primary sports blog, which deals with all sports nationally and internationally, very active. So we've got, I basically have about a third of the people that we had 10 years ago on the department, and we're doing three or four times as much, presenting three or four times as much material. So it's a huge challenge to be very efficient in your time, your use of time. But it's something that I think is really invigorating, just the immediacy of the website and of our blogs. All of our people tweet, some more ferociously than others, and we're all about expanding our brand as well, and we're now really trying to do that nationally as well as locally. So it's taken two of our people who were otherwise employed and are doing nothing but working on the web, starting at 6 in the morning and finding whatever is trending on Google or Yahoo and getting fresh material up on that. And that's been extremely successful for us.
Can I talk a little bit about local television sports reporting?
Sure.
Because I don't know if there are people...
No, you can't blame that on me.
No, not going to blame it on you. There may be people in the room who are interested in local television sports reporting, and from when I ran the news department at WNBC in New York, and when I ran the Channel 4 here, KNBC, and the two Telemundo stations, a lot has evolved in the past 15 years, I'd say, around local sports coverage. There was a time when I was in New York and running that news department, as I said, the sports department was under us. We used to give 4 minutes in an 11 o'clock newscast to sports. So these days, 11 p.m. newscasts go from 11 to 11:35. And once you take out the commercials, you're probably down to about 24 minutes, 25 minutes of content. We used to give 4 minutes to sports back then. Today, most sports departments are really scratching and fighting to get a minute and a half, maybe 2 minutes in markets where there are significant sports teams. In cities in Middle America where there is a sports franchise that's really well appreciated and it's a huge focus of the community, they may still get about 3 minutes. But the fact that sports is such an important part of the entertainment world, because sports is entertainment. So it's, the fans and viewers and public are very much consuming sports. And then at 11 o'clock at night, which used to be the marquee, you know, the big newscast of the day, we're seeing almost no time, in my estimation, given to sports. So it talks specifically about the future of sports reporting, sports anchoring for local television stations when we're seeing this contraction. And right now, East Coast versus West Coast, when a national team is playing and the game is over, usually on the East Coast, if it's an evening game, it goes straight to newscast. 3 hours. We have on the West Coast. We've got a three-hour time difference. You'll see local television sports departments will usually fill a gap until the top of the hour. So if the game ends here at 7:40, the local station has until 7:58 before they've got to kick it over to primetime, or 9:58 before they've got to kick it over to primetime. What this has resulted in is if you watch local television now and you watch sports, you'll see billboards where everything is sponsored. The ticker under the bottom is sponsored by an automobile company. The break into sports is sponsored. The break coming out of sports is sponsored. The logos of all kinds of advertisers is all over newscasts these days. And frankly, that is because that is really one of the few ways that television stations, having been in management and running the station, where you can figure out other ways to sell and get some kind of build a separate revenue model for the sports department. Because otherwise, these days, nobody is sitting up waiting until 11 o'clock at night to find out what happened. And you already saw it. You've been on all kinds of social media. You've tweeted, even if you never watched the game. And by the way, I would say that one of the reasons why the social media becomes such an important component of sports coverage is because whether you really like sports or not, you have to be in that conversation. Yeah. You just got to know what's going on, because these days it's almost a currency that I know something that you don't know. You don't know it? How stupid are you? I mean, I'm on top of everything, and this is why up at 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning, people are still up consuming information and getting up in the morning. What's the first thing I do? I walk over to my not flip phone, and I log in, and I got to find out what's happening. Why? I mean, it really isn't making my life any better or more meaningful. It really comes into importance when I am connecting with somebody else out there, and I can say, did you know that such and such happened? You go, really? Yes, I'm smart and you're not. And so with that, I'd say that unfortunately, local television news and the sports component is not helping that conversation, because it's already been out there. So I'm not exactly sure what the future of it is. But
there are two entities here. You have the internet, but where there has been this whole new world of sports reporting is on your regional sports channels, okay? And the fact that the 11 o'clock sportscast is 2 minutes instead of four, blame it on the weather guy here that needs 4 minutes to say it's going to be sunny tomorrow.
But as a team in this marketplace, one of the interesting things that we're seeing with social media is the old idea of it's going to be in the paper tomorrow or we're going to have a press conference. That information is out. We no longer fully control the message. The message is out there, and we have to figure out how to work with the information that's there. And in some cases, some of the blogs and tweets are not always fully accurate. So what what is that ripple to the organization? And how do we then, do you go right out into the marketplace with your correct message? And there's a time window, because time is so important to really get your message to protect your brand and the real message that you want portrayed. So that's something that we see really interesting. I don't know that we have the perfect answer or as evolved as kind of what the Suns are doing on some of the social media, but it's something that we talk about. We just had it with the announcement of our general manager. The press conference, everyone already knew who that individual was going to be.
Yeah. You know what? I have guys who work for us on air who are information reporters for the NFL, for baseball, and I've said to them, I'd rather be second and right, accurate, than first and wrong. And
that's because you're old school.
Well, and when we were I know that you got half of that right, old. But when we were growing up in the business, it became a cliche. You had to have two sources. Mm-hmm. My guys tell me if they wait to get that second source, somebody else will run the story on the internet before them.
Well, people aren't even making or the first phone source. Call. They don't
no
even
source.
Make
no,
the
well,
phone call. They just
no.
go.
I mean, and it that, gets
that's
very,
one of the issues.
It's very difficult for us on just credibility that you find something in a blog and stuff that, I don't know what it trends or blows up on the internet, and you almost feel obligated on a football show, our NFL show. Let's say that there's a report that Brady was busted for DUI in New England. And you do you have to, now, do you report that? Or do you call Bob Kraft or somebody at the Patriots and go, listen, there's this report. We don't want to go with it just off of what we read in the blog or the whatever, the tweet. We want to find out if it's true. And it gets very, very complicated as to what you run with and what you say. Wait a minute, guys, slow down.
But there's a difference between the blog and journalism. Now I'll turn it
no,
over to
no,
you.
Well,
because
there
is.
Well, there is.
There is.
There is.
I hope so.
I mean, this is the problem with sourcing and immediacy is something that that Ed certainly and I deal with every day, and he's right. The two source thing is out the window now on most stories. On really sensitive, complicated stories, you've got to really have things nailed down. You've got to be very sure of your sources, and for us, it's even more acute than it is for Ed, because Ed's on the air and he's talking about 6 minutes of time and being 6 minutes behind somebody. For a newspaper that doesn't come out until 6 o'clock the next morning, we're talking about several hours. So for us, the challenge is to present something in the paper that, because everybody knows the score, everybody knows who was hired, everybody knows who was fired. So that has reshaped what we do every day with the paper. We no longer have game stories in the paper. Our reporters who are assigned to cover the Dodgers or the Lakers or whatever team it is are there to, or the Sparks.
Yeah.
Are abbreviated. Yeah, are abbreviated.
We could use more coverage.
Yeah, that'll be. Let's talk offline.
Above the fold.
Yeah.
Do you let bloggers in your locker room? Guys that run blogs for Anaheim?
They're there. They're not.
Are they allowed in your locker room?
I don't
believe Are they allowed
so,
to practice? Are they allowed to report on your team? Like
oh, they do. Yeah,
like
absolutely.
Regular credentialed.
Well, we've got. I have a full time Laker blogger and a full time Dodger blogger, and they're both fully credentialed and they're solid journalists. They've got newspaper backgrounds, but all
they
do is blog.
But that's. I mean, there are folks out there that have no background. You can be a blogger if you want to be.
I do not envy your position in credentialing.
Yeah,
I think credentialing has become a major nightmare because someone who manages to be clever and create a website without any real reporting or without any journalistic background is a tough thing.
But there's
for you
a lot
to
of that out there.
There is a lot of that.
Yeah. So it becomes a lot of folks in the business. And I don't mean the professional reporters and the professional broadcasters, but a lot of people that are just out there reporting in one way or another for their own benefit or for some organization. Trying to be the first one out there with something is more important than trying to get something accurate. And there's so much that oftentimes we'll just throw it all against the wall, and if something sticks, fine. I'd rather be first with one story. To me, that's more important than being wrong 9 times. And so you get a lot of that out there.
That all goes to credibility of the news source to begin with. And most news organizations still subscribe to that. But in practicality, when I'm sitting in the office and I see something, I see some tweet about something that may have to do with Kobe Bryant or something, I'm on the phone with Mike Bresnahan, our Laker guy, and say, can you check this out? And so there's an incredible amount of running around to confirm something that's not confirmable.
Yeah. I can see you guys looked over here and you saw, here's a tired man who's off of a 10-hour plane flight. You're making my life so damn easy here. Thank you very much.
You don't look that tired.
Yeah, well, I, it's caffeine.
Well, we don't have
caffeine's
the
miracle drug.
We don't have a conversation like this either, so we're enjoying it.
Yeah. No, you're doing great, man. You're saving my life here. I mean, good grief. I don't have to do anything. I just set you guys going. And you know, normally I actually have to drag stuff out of people. You guys are making my life, all flowers. To follow this up, and I want to get back to another point that Mike made, so keep this in mind, because I want to talk about the international effect of the media on all of your organizations, because all of your organizations have to look at national and international audiences. You no longer can just look at the local audiences, so keep that in mind. But back to a point that Mike was making, years ago, G.K. Chesterton wrote a short story about a scandal, and at the end of the story he said, the scandal got in the newspapers, and for the rest of eternity, the truth was 30 minutes behind the scandal. And that is, to some degree, what happens in media. The scandal, the hit gets out there, TMZ puts something out, a blogger puts something out, and all of you end up chasing it one way or another, trying to chase it down and catch up with it. And that can be a great difficulty. How much more, and I'm going to say something here, that the last time I was sitting on a panel with Mike and mentioned this, he got really ticked off at me, so I'm hoping it gets him ticked off again. How difficult does this make your job? When in the middle of the Tiger Woods scandal, TMZ broke a tape that was of Tiger Woods' voice, supposedly, but nobody had gone back and done a fact check to make sure it really was Tiger Woods' voice, that was the claim. And ABC, NBC, and CBS Evening News, which used to be the arbiters of what was true news in the United States, all ran with it, with the caveat saying, this has not been checked, however. But they had to because they had no time. They had to be ahead of this. So you have what were really the true arbiters of news in the United States basically chasing TMZ. How difficult does that make your job?
It's very hard.
Yeah.
It's, you know, because TMZ actually does some good reporting, and I'm, but TMZ isn't right all the time, and TMZ isn't some, we have a policy at the paper where we don't use TMZ as an exclusive source.
Yeah.
But TMZ is out there doing the kind of work that we can't do, and I don't think Ed's people can do too, because it's extremely expensive to gather news, and it's really expensive to gather the kind of news that TMZ does, which is a lot of document work, it's a lot of legwork, and we do that when we think there's going to be a payoff in the story. We can't do that just by sending people out and starting searches without really knowing where we're going. But that's one of the real complications of any news organization right now is figuring how to catch up with things that break on the web with questionable sourcing and how much resource to devote to that, because it takes, if I've got six bodies working on six stories, it's tough to take one of those. That means I'm not going to get something else done that I know I need. So you've got to balance that every time, and it's a very tough call.
The reality of a TMZ, and we have every football season we get our producers, directors, and talent together for 3 days of sort of a mini camp, and every time I get the group together, I don't have a flip phone, but I show them the night before. At our dinner, and we probably start at the bar, and then we have a group dinner, and I have somebody go around with one of their cell phones, taking shots of our guys. And then the next day at our seminar, I point out that, guys, when you go out on the road, everybody's a reporter today. Everybody can get photos of you, and then we start running... of the photos. Bradshaw, what were you thinking at the bar there? Did you ever meet her before? I mean, but it does make the point. And with TMZ, there's an owner of a professional team who was in Las Vegas for a function that for his advertisers, for some of his key sponsors. And somebody took some video of him with a young lady who had actually asked, the boyfriend said, would you mind taking a photo with my girlfriend? Mm-hmm. And he does it. TMZ gets it, runs with it, and basically says, while this guy's team is losing every Sunday, he's out partying in Vegas.
Yeah. And he called. See, with me, it's always the young kids and the old ladies that want the pictures. Yeah. I never get the... Yeah.
That's how to stay off of TMZ, then.
That's a better situation altogether.
But if you say no to that photo, well, then these people are going to say, oh, well, like the signing an autograph. You sign 100, that 100 first one, well, you're a lousy person.
Yeah. Go ahead.
No, I was going to say, can I just... This notion of the big networks being the arbiters of journalism or setting the standards for journalism, I mean, that thing went out the window
long gone.
Some time ago, yeah. and you know,
what
I lament...
fair and balanced?
Yes. Yeah. I lament the day... There was a time back in my earlier days in journalism where I used to cringe at knowing that someone had been the public relations officer for a candidate... Mm-hmm. Or the chief strategist for a something, or with the spokesperson for the Defense Department, and then that administration goes out of favor, and then that person comes into the news department. I think we used to call that turnstile journalism. Mm-hmm. And it's been going on for a very, very, very long time. And back then, what I used to lament and sort of wring my hands and say, don't they understand? They are... blurring the line between journalism and not journalism. So that has become, you know, not even a conversation today. Mm-hmm. And that would be because we talk about bloggers the same way we talked about columnists. Mm-hmm. And columnists, at a point, there was a point where columnists had editors and they had to be fact-checking.
Sure.
Right?
Yeah.
And today, bloggers are bloggers, and they write what they want, and they get whatever the information is. And when that happened with Tiger Woods, well, you know, all the networks are kind of going, holy crap, mm-hmm. do we not report it? Okay, well, let's attribute it to TMZ. Mm-hmm. And that was the point where TMZ became a credible news organization, right? Mm-hmm. So in all of the fast-forwarding of everything that's going on today, I don't know that the way I grew up with those networks and those networks' news departments being the arbiters of journalism, I don't know that any 18, 19, 20, even maybe 30-year-old would say that. So whoever has an audience, right, and whoever's got a huge readership, and whoever's got however many thousands or hundreds of thousands of people following them and or liking them, that's a voice to be reckoned with. Yeah. So those of us who sit here in an owner's seat, you can't deny credentials to, at least I don't think so, to people who have a huge following, and whether you let them in or not, they're going to say something, and they have a following that listens to and lends some credibility to whatever it is that they're saying.
Hey, there's three individuals in China that each have 100 million followers. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, you think they carry
some
weight.
Any of them named Bieber?
But, you know, we're part of the challenge gets a little trickier now with social media. Say, for example, you get a local writer. He writes a story. He refers to somebody else's story, and that somebody else is referring to sources.
Yeah.
Okay? I can pick it up and read it. I know the article's completely not factual. Mm-hmm. But, you know, 2 or 3 years ago, I didn't worry quite as much about it because it just stayed local. Mm-hmm. But now every article's worldwide.
International.
So that information is not available for everybody.
Mm-hmm. Better yet, somebody's going to write a book on that subject that you just read about with misinformation. Mm-hmm. And 5 years from now, researching his book, well, it was in print 5 years earlier. It must be accurate. And it just continues.
Yeah. So it's challenging. I always love sources.
Of course.
Yeah. Okay.
To let out a deep, dark secret, the thing that really ticked Mike off was at the time I said, doesn't this event then make TMZ the arbiters of news? If everybody is going to that well, isn't TMZ the arbiter of what is true and what is false in news? And doesn't that become a problem? And doesn't that become a problem for all of you in the various ways in which you're trying to protect your message? And yet you have, as you say, bloggers, and really it's TMZ's not the worry here. TMZ's really not at all significant in this relative to, it seems to turn out that it is the volume of hits that generate what is news and what is not news.
Right.
Online.
Well, like for example, right now we have 40 employees that tweet. Mm-hmm. So we take it upon ourselves to be tweeting about our own brand. Mm-hmm. And they're trying to promote our brand. So they're tweeting videos, video clips, they're tweeting stories, they're tweeting information that the general public doesn't have access to, the behind-the-scenes kind of stuff that fans really crave.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we just have to take it upon ourselves to try to do a lot of that, too.
You know, this is one of the interesting evolutions of information distribution in this country. When I first started in the business, we distributed the news, essentially, and we covered your teams, and we essentially presented the news. Now, you are news providers, and we've become competitors.
Players.
Players are absolute competitors.
Didn't Shaquille O'Neal announce his retirement in a tweet?
Right.
Yeah. I remember one time walking in the locker room, and Shaq's on the table getting worked on, almost crying because they're keep doing this deep tissue kind of manipulation to get him loosened up, and it was kind of new to him. And he's sitting there with his little device, and I go, "What are you doing, big fella?" And he goes, "I'm just sending out a couple tweets." And says, "I got a million followers."
Yeah.
I go, "Well, before you hit send, don't you think you ought to read that thing over again?" I mean, and that's you know, I mean, it's
well, that's a whole other issue.
But players get to build their brand, and in many ways, that's a good thing. I think I'm not so sure it's real good during a season, because during a season, you know, you kind of want to have it like it's your team against the world, and everything in the locker room that happens, you want to stay private, and everything between the coach, you want to stay private, and now you'll see players say, well, this guy should have played, and that guy should have played, and, you know, I don't know, I guess maybe one day the coach is going to say, you know, this guy was out till 2 in the morning with this gal, and this guy drank too much, and he missed 3 assignments, and he should have tackled this guy, and I don't know if we'll get to that. But so during the season, I'm not so sure it's so good. But in general, players are creating their own brand through their followers, and I think that's a good thing. And I think in many ways, they act a lot more professional and keeps them more keenly aware of their brand. And, you know, from that standpoint, I think it's a good thing.
I think it works. I think it's extremely dangerous, as we've seen with innumerable cases in the last, you know, several months when inopportune tweets have gone out and gotten people in a lot of trouble. And it's one reason that I've got a Twitter account and I use it, but I am incredibly conscientious about it because I know that if I'm watching something and I send out a tweet about some guy who looks like a complete stiff, that's a really bad thing for the sports editor of the LA Times to be sending out. And I don't trust myself.
Right.
Because if I'm tweeting the way I would talk at a party, I'm going to have lots of time to tweet because I'm not going to have a job. So, but I think everybody has experienced the pitfalls.
I was with a fellow who works with his dad in a pretty high-profile business, and he's got a two-drink rule for his dad. After his dad has had two drinks, he won't let him tweet. He takes the thing away. He can't do it anymore.
We tell our announcers, if you wouldn't say it on the air, then don't tweet it.
Right. Yeah.
That's
well, we don't allow it in the locker room at halftime. We don't allow it within 30 minutes after a game. It's really become. I think a lot of folks, you know, even my age, oftentimes regret what they say online, and you kids out there too. You know, that's one thing I hate about online. The emailing and the text. People say things they wouldn't say in person to someone. You know, they're bullies online. It's, you know, in the old days when I was growing, if you had something to say to someone, you wrote a note to them, and you know, maybe you slept on it, you woke up in the morning, and yeah, you tore it up, and that's probably not good. But saying things and responding in the heat of the moment is not a good thing. You know, my kid got dumped by a text message, my son. 12 years old, gal texts him. You know, I was always out of your league, you know, and I got a new boyfriend. You know, well, you wouldn't say that to someone in person, you know. You wouldn't do that. I mean, a lot of this stuff happens where you just hit that send button.
Your son's going to kill you, you know.
My son? Yeah, probably.
He'll be happy to hear that.
I had a good idea. I said, you know what?
This right now.
Who's her best friend? Take her to the basketball game. Sit on the front row and I'll have a couple of the players come over and give you a high five. My wife said, you're not going to turn him into that kind of guy. But people just say and do things in the heat of the moment. You know, that maybe they wouldn't do if they weren't able to send it out so quick. So, you know, before you hit that send message, guys, be careful, gals, too. Careful.
Same thing can happen when you're on a panel. You never know what you're going to say.
That's true. You're right. My son won't hear this panel.
You are being recorded, and it will go online. So,
okay, well, maybe he will.
Don't let your son find out.
It won't surprise him.
Now, one further complication of all of this, though, as we've noted, is that you gain interest and you gain importance by the number of followers you have, and you gain followers by the volume, not just the volume of tweets, but the volume of interest in the tweets, which means the more edgy and extreme you can make your tweets, and the more you can push on the truth, the more followers you can gain. Given that, who protects truth? I know that's like Pilate now asking, you know, what is truth? I just wanted to see if anybody would answer it. Who protects?
I think that's what I was referring to earlier. I think that's what's very complicated about the environment that we're in right now is, as a brand, to what lengths do you go to have some protection? Do you let misinformation out there? Do you try to fight down every piece of misinformation? Mm-hmm. I do think there's incredible opportunity because with this type of environment, you have the ability to establish a relationship with your fans. There are ways to target certain portions of the demographics of your fan to appeal to different elements. To women, you can have a different type of conversation to your female mother, you know, fans where they're buying tickets for the household versus attracting to the younger male demographic with keeping the game interactive or edgy or knowing what's going on with the players. So the opportunity is out there. There's also the risk of this immediacy that we're all facing.
Mm-hmm. I mean, truth is, in my business, truth is, we can't get away from truth. That's what we do. And if we begin to start spitballing and throwing things up there to see if they'll stick, we've lost our credibility, and our credibility is really the only thing that keeps us going. It's in a economic time when there's contraction, there's a lot of consolidation with news organizations partnering with other news organizations and losing a lot of independence. If we get away from presenting accurate, thoughtful information, then we've got nothing to sell at all.
Yeah, and that's obviously of core importance for a news organization, a major news organization, and yet you have to go into a den of lions online and play with people who are constantly blogging information that you are going to, you on one side have to deal with in terms of trying to identify what is true and what is not true and give an authoritative voice to the things that are true. And then, of course, sports organizations and Fox also, you have to play the balance to try to get out your message effectively in spite of all of these challenges from information that may or may not have any basis in truth and things that you have to chase down. Now, in terms of going to the other question that I wanted to talk about a little bit here, and we're going to go terribly, terribly late if we don't get to it. So speaking to an international audience, certainly Ted Turner in the 1990s showed that you can create a national audience, even for the Atlanta Braves, who knew, and generate interest in a team that did not have a lot of interest in the 70s and the 80s. It created as a national team by putting it on what amounted to national network consistently. in sports now, the LA Times, as you mentioned, the LA Sparks, the Phoenix Suns, the Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim and Orange County and all of that, and the Fox Sports, all of you are now international organizations. By the nature of the beast, you sell to a local audience, a national audience, an international audience. I'm going to start and just work left to right. That makes things simple. Beginning with Ed, how do you create an international brand for Fox?
Well, first off, when we do rights deals with the various leagues, it's just for domestic rights. So the World Series was seen in, I don't know, 150 countries. We only had the rights for the United States. Now, where we do have an international footprint is Sky Sports in Great Britain, Star over in Asia, Sky Italia, Sky Germany. So those organizations really are our international platform, but it's not for necessarily the NFL or baseball or whatever else we're televising. I think if there is one, well, there are probably two sports that on an international platform have really grown and will continue to grow. I think basketball has done a great job internationally. And what's happening in this country, I think, and as we move forward, major international soccer events, those audiences are growing in this country and around the world. So that's it from the Fox perspective, but it's really not about us building an international brand for what we do here.
Molly, the baseball does have an international audience.
The teams in Taiwan.
What's that?
Absolutely. Yeah, they just got back from Taiwan.
Yeah. So how do you go about the Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim are in Orange County? How do you create a national and an international audience for a local team?
On the pure business side, at a local level, obviously, our turnstile is not going to be increased for our international exposure. Where I look at it is our international exposure in the brand, in attracting the talent, in our presence in the Dominican Republic and in Venezuela. We saw international exposure when we signed Hideki Matsui with the Japanese media coverage. We had really never seen anything like that with the number of media coverage, the respect that we discussed that the Japanese players give to their media. Really increase the exposure of the Angels in the Asia market, which will help with recruiting other players and signing them. We also participated in the World Baseball Classic in 2006, and one of the most interesting games for me personally was Japan-Korea. It was a sold-out game, and the extent to which the fans with flags and their love and desire for the game and to see international individuals cheering for their team, it was unbelievable. It was an amazing crowd, sellout, the excitement was unbelievable, and it was a wonderful experience for our organization to sense the presence of baseball in these other countries. It was part of MLB's initiative to grow the sport. MLB is very active in trying to grow the sport internationally, and the local clubs participate with the league in that national program.
Robert, as was mentioned, the NBA may be the most successful national organization in the United States in creating an international audience. Certainly has been very aggressive, especially in the Pacific Rim. The Phoenix Suns, however, are in the middle of a desert.
Well, you'd be surprised.
Yeah.
That's true. I think the NBA has been kind of the leader, and mainly just because the sport is popular all throughout the world. So anywhere you go in the world, you're going to see kids with two things. One is a basketball, one's a soccer ball. I mean, that's pretty much everywhere, even places you wouldn't even think it exists. And one of the beauties about both soccer and basketball is both men and women and boys and girls both play. You know, it's not like you're not going to get a football game with a bunch of 8-year-old gals playing somewhere. So it's very popular throughout the world. About a third of the players in the NBA are foreign. And so they tend to have big followings. And at any one time, I remember one year we had players from seven different countries on our team. And so they've got very big followings. The NBA's been very active at promoting its brand overseas. And it's kind of, in a way, sports is easy to do that, because what it is that you're playing overseas is a game which can be shown, you know, basically you don't have to retranslate the whole thing. If you were going to produce the David Letterman show in China, you'd have to recreate the whole show. But if you're going to show a basketball game in China, you just need to show it. There's more people playing basketball in China than live in the United States. Mobile devices, the amount of mobile devices that a person has in the United States, we're in the low end of what folks carry around in other countries, especially in Europe. And so, you know, we're big at promoting our brand, and where the Phoenix Suns brand gets promoted overseas is more probably attributable to the players that happen to be on our roster that come from overseas that are very popular. And it's amazing how popular, a lot of these folks are when they go overseas, and the turnout and attention they get. And so I guess basketball is blessed. We've opened up offices in Abu Dhabi. We've got offices in India. We've got offices all over the world building stadiums and promoting the brand.
Now, if you can get a labor agreement.
Yeah. No comment.
No comment.
Speaking of NBAs, with the WNBA, now you from what you've said already, Paula, you actually do a very good job of creating a program for a diverse audience in the Southern California region, but then reaching out and expanding from their national and international audiences. How do you target those audiences and generate a larger audience than for the LA Sparks through that?
Well, I mean, I think one of the things about the let me do a little more open first about the WNBA. So the WNBA piggybacks on the Nothing But Nets program that the NBA has, which they conduct in a lot of African nations and some Asian nations, and the nets being mosquito nets to minimize malaria victims. So for like less than $1, you can buy a mosquito net, and then children and adults will live longer. So the NBA has the Nothing But Nets program, but they also have this sort of, it's more like an ambassadorship. So throughout China and Africa in particular, players will go to those nations and conduct basketball clinics. The other truism for the WNBA, frankly, is that a significant majority of the players are African American. And my family also owns a cable network called the Africa Channel, and we've been shooting a documentary for a while now where we have worked with some of the players to trace their DNA, their ancestry, to particular African nations. And so we'll follow some of them back to their tribes, and they'll go. We got the approval of the WNBA. They'll go and they'll take their basketballs, and maybe if basketball is not being played in that particular area, whether Ghana, which plays a lot of basketball, but that we'd shoot that and bring basketball to these various foreign nations. The other way that it happens, frankly, is, as I mentioned, lots of WNBA players play overseas. Lots of them play overseas. That is really where they make their incomes. And then every 4 years with the Summer Olympics, we lose players because we lose our foreign-born players because they sit out that season so that they can represent their national teams in the Summer Olympics. And so what we see is, and I don't know if it's as great in the NBA, although I think it is, but what we see is much more interest in women's basketball every time the Olympics happens, because, you know, when the Russian team plays or the Chinese team plays or the Australian team plays, and they come as close as they do in the various rounds, then of course we start scouting those players, or we've been scouting those players. So there is an appreciation, and then there are many more NBA teams that are televised than WNBA teams. A lot of our games are streamed live, and the access and the ability to watch our games is more a part of the fan culture, where they will watch online, because a lot of times maybe only 6 games will be televised in a region or in a market, as opposed to a full 25 or 30.
There were more live games televised nationally in China than there were in the United States last year in our season.
In the NBA?
Mm-hmm.
Interesting. Although in some respects not surprising. Yeah. Mike, in with the LA Times, and you've talked a little bit about this, how do you create an international brand for the LA Times?
Well, that's difficult. We can't cast the kind of net that Fox or that the NBA can internationally, but that said, we spend a lot of money covering events like the Olympics. We'll have probably 12 or 13 people in London. And we find that when we cover major events internationally, the World Cup in South Africa, we had two people there for the whole time, and a substantial amount of our online readership comes from overseas on events like that. Manny Pacquiao, the boxing champion, we've sort of become the official newspaper of Manny Pacquiao. Whenever he fights, we do live round by round blogging of his fights, and our traffic spikes, at least doubles when he's doing that, and a huge portion of that is from the Philippines. And we, with several Latin American fighters, we do the same thing, and we get the same reaction there. Mm-hmm. But in terms of, really expanding internationally, it's something that we don't have the resources really to do beyond this kind of major event.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the major event coverage. Okay, seriously, can we kick all these people out? I'll buy you all a late dinner. We can just sit around and have a conversation for another couple of hours here. I mean, you guys got nothing better to do, right? We need to finish up, but I want to finish with a question. We're going to go reverse order again on this, and the question is very simple. Where is the future in news or in sports reporting? In sports ownership, in the executive work that you do, if you could encapsulate it in three or four sentences, where is the future?
Oh, boy, three sentences.
Four.
Give me six.
Six.
Okay,
I'm counting.
Okay, here is my concern, and I'm very concerned about the future because I think daily journalism is incredibly important on so many levels here. And because it's so expensive and because it is under such restraints right now, I worry about the viability of keeping news organizations financially going. And the result of that, as teams expand their writing staffs to get their message out, is that the gatekeepers are people who need to, we're sort of the gatekeepers. We need to present good information and bad information. And if we continue to struggle the way we are right now, it's a great concern to me that at some point you're going to find most of your information coming from sources that have a vested and reasonable interest in that information and determining what is actual news and what is news that's skewed to present a certain side of it is going to be more and more difficult. So it's really important for us, I think, to continue finding ways to make to keep ourselves viable.
Viable and important, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Paula?
I think that I earlier characterized sports as entertainment, and I think because of that and because there's so much interest and continuing interest in entertainment, I think that the interest in sports is only going to get bigger. I don't see any way, shape, or fashion in the future that this will contract in any way. The tough part, what Mike was just referring to in terms of gatekeepers, the internet kicks through gates. I mean, it just doesn't allow for gates. Mm-hmm. And consequently, I would say that as we've seen, certainly has been borne out over the past decade, the pressure on news organizations and the traditional and legacy news and journalistic entities, there's going to be a problem. There's going to continue to be a problem and great pressure because information is information, whether you characterize it as journalism or not. So what we've done, what I was referring to earlier, is it's not as siloed as this is journalism, and therefore you have to come to me for journalism. It's all information. And I think it'll be up to an educated public to determine whether or not you are giving as much credence to a blogger as you are to, for example, the LA Times. Now, without being an educated public, there are going to be a lot of mistakes made and a lot of bad information swallowed, which, by the way, has been going on for decades. But it will be a discriminating public, a discriminating fan base that would determine the viability of sports journalism. I'm characterizing that differently than sports media, sports journalism. So I think that there will be a smaller, frankly, a smaller cadre of people who are truly sports journalists. And there'll be a lot of people who are just out there writing and sharing information. In terms of teams and ownership of teams, I think that, you know, for, frankly, for male sports, I think, again, it's only going to grow and get bigger. And the pressure, again, on who gets to participate at what level and who gets to share in the spoils at what level, that's going to continue to be a big issue, driven largely by, frankly, the television rights and the media rights to a lot of what the teams are doing, which is their activities and their play. I think for female sports, I'm not seeing right now that that there will be an expansion or a growth or a burgeoning interest, because frankly, it still is a tough, it's tough to get the public interested and behind and supporting women's sports and women's and women athletes. So I don't know when that's going to change. I pray. I pray as Ed was praying, but I pray that people will begin to take a harder and longer look and support women's sports much more so than they do.
This has become a very religious meeting here.
We're getting a check now from ESPN for the WNBA.
Yes, we are.
For the first time in the last couple of years. And so in many cases in our market, we've outdrawn hockey in terms of our ratings. Yeah. And so I hope you're right, too. I pray for that, too. I think women's sports are great. I think sports, team sports in general, help create leaders, leadership. You know, I encourage everybody to play team sports, all kids to play team sports. Teach you how to interact with people, teach you how to respect a coach, teach you how to be leaders, teach you how to compete, know what it feels like to compete, work together. I think team sports are great. Let me first say, it's the first time I've been to this campus ever. It's beautiful, so all of you kids that go to school here are lucky to be going here. And I'll just say this about the question you asked. Whatever it is we think today, it's going to change 6 months from now. As I told you, the way we look at media with the Phoenix Suns today is completely different than we looked at it 12 months ago. And one of the things that successful people do is adapt to change easily and focus on being proactive instead of reactive. And so for all you kids going to school out there that are going to get into work, the better you adapt to change, the more resilient you are, the more successful you're going to be.
Molly?
Well, I'm excited about the future. What I see in the future is teams and leagues finding ways to innovate using technology to keep their brands relevant, to maintain a connection with their fans, with their players. I see it as a way to grow the leagues and the sports domestically and internationally. I would like to find ways to use technology. We're exploring in the league digital ticketing and how does that technology serve to give us more information about the people attending our games and how can we interact with the individuals that are attending the games so that their experience is improved. I'd like to find ways to use the technology to increase our customer service, increase fan satisfaction, make them feel part of the organization and part of a family so that there's connectedness. And I see technology as an excellent way to do that, as well as with social media, how we get our message out and deliver our brand.
Just off of what Paula was saying, I think the one thing you're going to see, and it's not going to change, the leagues are going to get more and more money. You will see a new cycle of NFL negotiations where every broadcaster, that would be, you know, currently Fox, CBS, NBC, and ESPN, every one of those networks will be paying the NFL over $1 billion a year for the television rights. ESPN has already completed their negotiation. They've gone from, what, $1.1 billion to $1.9 billion. CBS, Fox, and NBC, the range is currently between, let's say, $650 million and $750. Everybody's going to be bumped to well over $1 billion. So there's going to be more and more money. Baseball will be negotiating a new national television deal next year. Those figures are going to jump dramatically. Whoever ends up buying the Dodgers, is either they're going to get it from Fox or Time Warner. Currently, the Dodgers receive a little under $40 million a year for the local Fox rights. That's going to jump to $150 million a year. So there's always going to be more money. That's because it is entertainment, and the audiences for that entertainment are larger than anything else. The top-rated 10 top-rated network television shows this year, 8 of them will be sports, whether it's the World Series, the NBA Finals, or the NFL. So it does have that power. The other thing you're going to see is more and more TV everywhere. It's not just going to be on your television set where you're going to watch the game. If you're out, you're going to watch it on the tablet. You're going to watch it on your flip. Well,
good luck.
3 out of 4. But it's going to be everywhere, and then it's a battle of who owns those rights. Mm-hmm. Because the leagues get a little greedy. They want us to write them a check for the television rights, but they hold the rights to everything else. And in fact, we're so goofy in our negotiations as network executives. We sign a deal where we'll pay you $1 billion a year to televise these football games. And as soon as that broadcast is over, you own the broadcast. We don't even own it. So you can now recycle it on your NFL network, on the NBA network. You're going to see more and more of that, but it'll be not just the networks owning those rights. And then I think the challenge for team owners, because you got all this great broadcast material, is to make the in-stadium experience exciting and enough fun so people are going to get out of their house to come see the events live. And that'll be a challenge.
As we start to conclude here, I want to bring up something that Paula mentioned, the question of educating the public. This is a core question here. As all of this information floods out to the public, the question that we always ask is, who educates the public? How does the public get to know what is an authoritative source and what is not? And what's fascinating about this statement is that this is a question that has existed all the way back to Plato. Plato asked, who educates the public? How is the public educated so it knows the truth from a lie? And whose responsibility is this? And those of us who work in academe and those of you who are going to go out and be the leaders of the next generation and the generation after that, that's one of the questions you need to take away from this evening. Who is going to educate the public and help the public see where truth lies and help the public see where the blog is a lie? What's interesting here is, for one thing, I had to ask very few questions, which is not the normal situation in this. And number two, an hour-long program has just gone an hour and a half, and it seems like it barely started. Now, the reason for that is the 5 people sitting at my right. I wish to God I'd been sitting for the last hour and a half, but the 5 people sitting to my right made that happen. And so I want you to thank every one of them, from Ed down to Mike. This is an exceptional discussion with exceptional people, and I am hoping that they work their way very slowly out of the building here so you get a chance to talk to them, because they have some very strong opinions and some incredibly valuable ones that you've heard from this evening. So I want to thank all of our guests once again for taking part in this panel discussion as part of the Nike-sponsored Sports and Social Change Speaker Series held by the USC Annenberg's Institute of Sports, Media, and Society. We will see you in February to talk about the Olympics. Thank you very much.